Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of the Manu Sharma Show. Today with us, we have someone who has 25 years of consulting experience in IT companies, and he's the founder of NINtec and former chairman of NICCT, Mr. Vipin Moharir. Welcome Vipinji to the show.
Thank you very much, Manu. Thank you very much.
Could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Where are you from and what led you to come to the Netherlands?
I was sitting one day at home and figuring out, should I be in the US or in Australia or in the UK? My uncle, Dr. Moharir, who was a professor here in the Institute of Social Studies, happened to be in India at that time. And he said, well, young man, he said, all these are very easy places for you to go because they're all English-speaking countries. So he said, look, Europe is growing. There is a lot of graying going to happen in Europe. There is European Monetary Union coming up. There is one currency coming up. So there is a huge requirement for intelligent young people with a good professional skill. So that's how I actually, you know, chanced upon Holland. And then I started looking at what opportunities Holland had. And this is, mind you, 1993-94.
Okay.
And that's how I landed up to do my master's in Maastricht. I was probably one of the first ones to get even a visa or a work permit, you know, let's say processed after I started doing my job. I stayed with a Dutch family, being in their house as a paying guest, and very loving family, extremely high values. And I just felt at home. So that was my first, let's say, introduction to Holland.
How was your journey of becoming a CEO like?
Exciting, tiring, and also difficult. To just tell you a little bit about the background, so after I finished my master's in Maastricht, I started working for an American company, Computer Sciences Corporation at that time. I became a strategic IT consultant for them. And I got tired of consulting very quickly. Over 3-4 years, I got tired of consulting because it's not in my DNA to just advise someone what to do. So after that, I became IT operations person for 3 years and worked in the UK and again Holland. But deep down in my heart, I was and I'm always an entrepreneur.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, let me go to India. So I said, how do I find a partner? Advertisement all across India, Times of India, Indian Express. And I could not find really a match between the people who were responding and what I wanted to do. So having worked for 5-6 years in Holland and across, you know, Europe and America, I could really figure out where is that exact niche in which I would like to put up my organization.
Okay.
So I was traveling from Pune to Ahmedabad in a train. And after about 15-20 minutes, my father, who was traveling with me,
okay,
he said, I would like you to meet someone. I look in front and there's a young man just recently married. His wife is there, an Indian bride. She's crying because obviously leaving her father's home, going to Ahmedabad. And I started talking to this young man. And 5 o'clock in the morning, we had the business plan ready. So that was my business partner that I met in the train.
Wow.
His name is Neeraj. And we've been together in business. I have two business partners, Neeraj and Inder in India.
Okay.
But we've been in business for the last 25 years. And basically, when you set up your organization and you are the leader, then you tend to get the title of CEO. In the early years, of course, the CEO is more of, you know, chief do-everything officer.
Yes.
And then, of course, as the company grows, then you start taking more and more executive responsibility.
What were the challenges of having a co-partner?
You need to overcome the cultural challenges. And especially in our case, we have a very globally spread organization. So it makes it a little bit more challenging because a person in, let's say Finland thinks in a different way than a person in India. A person in Holland thinks in a different way. The expectations are different. The communication is different.
Yes.
So it's a very interesting area. But the challenges primarily have to do with ensuring that you speak the same language in the sense your own DNA.
Yes.
And once that is done, then I think there's no challenge that cannot be overcome in any form of partnership.
Vipinji, which challenges did you face when expanding business across 17 countries?
You know, there is something called as management by scarcity.
Hmm.
Okay, so when you have very little things actually to your disposal, then you automatically become innovative.
Hmm.
So that is one thing that I have found myself, you know, in the last 25 years, innovating out of the box. So the reason for us to go to these different countries was driven by risk management.
Hmm.
It was a strategy that we said we want to have a risk spreading strategy. Because when US goes down, 2006-2007,
right,
we saw Europe suddenly turning up, you know, and Europe suddenly started growing very, very rapidly,
yes,
especially Scandinavia and the Nordics. The exciting part of going to these different countries and the challenging part at the same time is how do you relate to the local culture?
Yes.
How do you relate to the local expectations? How do you relate actually to identifying the needs and then defining it in such a way that you can explain it to your teams in India to be actually produced in India? So it's in fact produced in India, but made for Holland. Yes. Produced in India, but it's made for Finland. In professional terms, we call it bridge engineering.
Okay.
So that bridge engineering is one of the most critical things actually to do while expanding to these countries. So in Holland, if you see, my company is not an Indian company with an office in Holland. Mm-hmm. It's a Dutch company.
Yes.
With an office in India. So we've managed to actually, you know, do right the identification, the branding in such a way that even the people working in these offices, they actually completely relate to the local environment in which they are.
Yes.
And that's been a very defining success factor for us to go there in these countries and set up your own offices and local teams. It's an exciting journey.
What are ways for companies to grow organically in foreign countries? And does this differ across the continents?
So when I became an entrepreneur, none of the business partners, we come from a business family. Okay, so we had business entrepreneurship ambitions. Mm-hmm. But we did not have, let's say that backing of a business family and somebody who said, hey, listen, this is your 1 million startup capital, and then you start going and, you know, kind of spending it and do something with it.
Mm-hmm.
It was exactly vice versa. So our parents, you know, they told us that, listen, these are the boundaries which you should not be crossing. Now, 20 years down the line, if you ask me whether it was a good strategy, I might be in a dilemma. We were not, let's say the old Gen IT company, which started in the 1990s, and they had a huge, let's say, growth period because of the millennium and because of euro conversions and so on and so forth. We are the year 2000, and India post 2000 is a different IT, let's say, arena. So that automatically brought in a lot of out-of-the-box thinking, automatically brought a lot of, out-of-the-box innovation into the organization, and because of which we became one side cost-conscious, and on the other side, extremely aggressive, because when you only have that 5 euros to spend and you know that that's the rocket that you want to build, mm-hmm. and that's the moon that you want to achieve, then you become very, very innovative.
Yes.
So it's a positive and it's a negative, that what I would say, but mostly it is very, very positive.
How would you define success?
So success is a series of small milestones that lead me to the large vision, which I have set up for myself. Definition of success also changes for an entrepreneur depending upon the entrepreneurship cycle in which they are. We had started the business, and with a tremendous amount of support from family and especially, my wife and my kids, almost every Saturday sitting down with my wife on a dining table, and I say, listen, shall I start applying for jobs next week? And this was not a one-off. This was a regular affair every Saturday for at least 6 months, I remember, in 2002. But you need to define, where is that final line which you do not want to cross and compromise on your basic, let's say, principles that you have set up for yourself. So I remember at that time my success was, can I actually close a project of 10,000 euros or 20,000 euros? And that is something which is a very difficult thing to explain to somebody and even explain to myself now. Because today, even if I sign a million euro contract, I probably think, well, you know, it is but natural that we would sign it because we've grown to a certain size and so on and so forth.
Yes.
So those small successes at that point in time, those small milestones at that particular time have suddenly become big milestones, big success milestones.
Mm-hmm.
And the vision is still there. I'm busy with a very interesting inorganic strategy for my company. And one of the principles is that I would like to make as many millionaires as possible in India in my company.
Oh.
So we would like to have a buy and build strategy. So what we're currently doing is raising a large fund, and we will start acquiring companies in Europe, and we will bring them onto the same principles of bridge engineering, a global success delivery model. We'll bring them on to, let's say, the same principles of a very simple economic principle.
Mm-hmm.
Produce wherever you can produce in the most cost-optimized fashion with the right quality, and sell in the markets where you have the maximum amount of margin. So it's a very simple, let's say, principle, of course, while balancing, I would say, people, planet, and profit. So this is the triple bottom, criteria. So that's my definition of success today. Vipin, when would you be successful in 2018? If I were to able, in December 2018, achieve these milestones,
mm-hmm.
then I would look back and with 2018 with a happiness and a smile.
Sounds really great. What is the way to realize the vision of an innovative project?
I think one really needs to find out what is really the need associated to the problem that you want to solve in a specific market or a specific sector or a specific business problem.
Mm-hmm.
Then you need to have the guts to actually think outside the box.
Yes.
You need to think with probably a little bit of destructive mindset, because without destruction, you cannot create.
Mm-hmm.
Apply everything that you have in your arsenal with respect to technology, with respect to process innovation, with respect to all the other, let's say, techniques that you have learned, and then identify the solution that is completely different from the traditional methods of having done that business problem solution, maybe for the last 50 or 100 years. Within the digital disruption age today, one of the critical things that we tell ourselves, in fact, and we tell the customers, which is a very difficult thing which I'm going to tell, is fail fast and fail cheap. Now, from a traditional perspective, you might ask, why do you want to fail at all, right? But we know that this disruption is going to require solutions which have never been done before, because it's a new way of doing things, which means that the first time you have the solution, you may not be successful. The chances, in fact, that you will not be successful the first time are much higher than vice versa. So you must condition your mind to fail fast and fail cheap, and that's the only way to tackle disruption.
How can gamification be applied in industries as healthcare and automotive?
Consumers are looking for very unique methods in which they can actually absorb the information, they can absorb the content. And gamification is an interesting method of actually bringing the content to your final users. And let me give you an example over here. We did a project some time back where a very, very difficult disease, in this case it was like MS, can actually be gamified, because it's a disease which is very difficult for the patient to understand, and it's also a very difficult disease for the doctor to explain it to the patient. A gamification process actually leads to the consumer, in this case the patient, actually understanding what's happening in a much better fashion, and the doctor in that case also being able to relate, you know, much better. And if you see nowadays virtual reality or mixed reality, in fact, you know, virtual reality is gone, is passe. You have currently mixed reality where people are actually able to not just see, but they're also able to smell. So you're able to sit in your own chair, you are able to configure your new car, and you are able to maybe drive it virtually, and then you take a decision whether you want to buy it or not. And all this time, you have the experience, the smell of the new car, the way the seats are going to feel in the new car. So that's one, you know, let's say reality, virtual reality, which we have not yet experienced, but it's coming. It's the disruption, it's coming. And the kids of tomorrow, I would not be surprised if grandparents, you know, sitting out of India or America are talking to the kids actually with a virtual reality goggle, and they're actually playing games together in a virtual space. And they have a feeling of physical closeness that we basically today are used to in a very different fashion. So, gamification is just the tip of the iceberg. I think we have many, many years to go before we really see the applications of these kind of technologies.
Thank you very much, Vipinji, for your time, for your insights, to coming down to the studio.
Thank you very much, Manu. I really thoroughly enjoyed myself, and it was a very, very interesting conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.